Hello and welcome to India's World. Today we are going to discuss the political developments in Crimea, the southern province of Ukraine. Crimea has 60% ethnic Russian population and is considered a pro-Russian province. Crimea also hosts the Russian Black Sea Fleet and is Russia's access to the warm waters of the Mediterranean through the Black Sea. The European Union and the US are confronting what they call a belligerent Russia, which seeks to protect its strategic interests in Crimea as the rest of Ukraine becomes pro-West. This may lead to President Putin accepting the request of Crimea for integration into Russia. The West, however, sees this as an illegitimate process, which is against Ukrainian law as well as international law. To understand the rapidly developing crisis in Crimea and its implications, we have with us a very distinguished panel of experts. We have with us Ambassador Rajiv Sikri, former Secretary in Ministry of External Affairs. You've had two long stints in Moscow. You've been our ambassador to Kazakhstan. And you've been head of the erstwhile Soviet and East European Division. That's so welcome right. to the discussion. Ambassador Sudhir Devare, again a former secretary from the Foreign Office, Director General of Indian Council for World Affairs. But your real distinction for the purpose of this program is you were the first Indian ambassador to Ukraine. And Ambassador V.B. Soni, also ambassador to Ukraine, who knows that country very well. So Mr. Soni, welcome to the discussion. Let me begin with you, Ambassador Rajiv Sikri. Who has the upper hand in Ukraine today? The West, which claims that it is there to promote democratic values, human rights, and Ukrainian independence? Or Russia, which has real geopolitical interests in that region?
In my mind, Russia. Because Russia has more vital interests at stake in Ukraine, and therefore will take the extra measures, go the extra step to ensure that its interests are protected.
What are these interests?
Well, I think there are three important interests that come to mind immediately. One is the Black Sea Fleet, Crimea, which is what we are discussing today. Without Crimea, which is on a long lease to Russia, which has always been a Russian province, but it was given by Khrushchev in 54 to Ukraine. Without that, there is no Russian Navy, there is no Black Sea Fleet, and Russia as a naval power would practically cease to exist. Number two, there's an integrated old Soviet military industrial complex, and a lot of the facilities, critical facilities, are in Ukraine. If Ukraine is not with Russia, the Russian military industrial capabilities in space, nuclear, aircraft production, all these would get degraded. Number three, there is no natural border between Ukraine and Russia. And if there is a hostile presence, particularly if Ukraine is a part of NATO, then Russia's physical security is threatened.
Mr. David, do you agree with Mr. Rajiv Sikri? These are the only strategic reasons, or there's also the reason of a large ethnic Russian population there? He wants to protect those, or says that he's constitutionally authorized to protect Russians anyway. Access to the sea, or making the Black Sea, as it already is, a Russian lake?
No, Crimea is critical. In fact, I recall soon after Ukraine became independent, 1991, December, in the first 2 years, there were very intense negotiations. Yeah. On Crimea, and I was that time in Kiev, which subsequently led to the long lease of Crimea to Russia, also the autonomous character of the Crimean Republic. All that I think was going on fairly well. It seems that the West did not quite really realize that they were in raising this pitch to such a high extent, leading to this particular situation in which they might now see Crimea asking for a merger with Russia. In fact, in a way, I think the Russians have played their trump card on Crimea, a region which has traditionally been with Russia for centuries, which only Khrushchev gave away in 1954. But that time he didn't expect that Soviet Union.
Moment, some people
yeah,
say.
And Soviet Union will not break up at that time. So it didn't really matter. Ukraine was part of the Soviet Union. Well, of course, there is nearly 40% population in Ukraine which is of Russian origin.
60 something.
I'm talking about whole of Ukraine.
60% is Crimea.
Crimea, but 30 to 40% and concentrated in the east. Interestingly, all the major industrial centers of Ukraine are in the area of Russian majority
east
speaking.
And south.
Eastern, Donetsk, Dnepropetrovsk, Kharkov, Zaporozhye, Lugansk, all these places. Yeah. So, for Russia, this is really very vital. And for Ukraine too.
Yeah. Master Soni, sorry to interrupt you. No. Master Soni, who has more leverage? Clearly, the EU also has leverage because it's a source of financial assistance to Ukraine. But trade and energy links are with Russia. So, the leverage today is with whom?
Let me first of all address some of the issues which you have discussed earlier. Ukraine, in the eastern, is the real thing where all the important segments of the Ukrainian economy are based. He mentioned about Kharkiv. Kharkiv is the place which produces the T-80UD tanks which were supplied by them to Pakistan. Then there are a whole lot of the space related technology also is based there.
But East has not opted for Russia. East is not opting for Russia.
No, East wants a closer interaction with Russia. Yeah. That is the issue. Yeah. But more importantly, you talked about Crimea. Now, Crimea is, of course, strategically important. Mr. Sikri mentioned about the presence of their fleet there because for them, this is the only outlet they have through Black Sea to the Mediterranean. But more importantly, in addition to the strategic interest, it doesn't have that much of economic backing, as it were. The economic backing is more in the east. So the first step, of course, is Crimea, but you have to see what it'll lead to. Won't stop there at Crimea.
All right. So we need to take a break at this point. We'll be back again with this interesting discussion in a bit. Don't go away. Welcome back. We are discussing the developing crisis in Crimea. Ambassador Sikri, to what extent is the competition between the East and Russia actually aggravating the crisis in Ukraine? The 2004 Orange Revolution was encouraged by EU and the United States financially and otherwise. Then Russia reacted to it and discredited the Orange Revolution. So EU came back and Russia came, the US came back with the Euromaidan or the Independence Maidan movement. Mm. And now Russia's reacted by going into Crimea.
You know, when the Soviet Union broke up, Russia was content to be a junior partner. But the West wanted to finish off Russia strategically. And the biggest target, the most important target, was Ukraine. They failed because of various factors which we need not go into right now. The Euromaidan, the 2004 Orange Revolution, did not succeed. Yanukovych came back. But this stakes are very high for Russia there. And I think that Ukraine is not the symbol of the East-West conflict, but the cause of the conflict. It's the very fundamental issue. There is no region that is more important to Russia than Ukraine, perhaps Belarus, but Belarus is with them, and northern Kazakhstan and the Caucasus. But Ukraine is number one because of the various factors that we have discussed. There's one other point I want to bring in. You mentioned about the people, you know, Russian origin people. Yes, I think it's a very important and under-assessed factor. You know, just as we have in Tamil Nadu people feeling for the Tamils of Sri Lanka, similarly Russians there also feel. But more important reason is that these are Russian people who, if they become part of Russia, would add to Russia's population, which is declining. So it's a huge resource. So it's not just emotion, it's a huge resource which would add to Russia's strength.
Okay, that's an excellent point you made. Ambassador Devare, do you think Crimea will eventually secede from Ukraine? And how soon could this happen after the referendum?
Well, coming back to this earlier point, I think there is a clear tussle between the EU and Russia, West and Russia, you can say. And in fact, Ukraine has become a kind of a pawn in this geopolitical game, which is really very sad.
A willing pawn.
A willing pawn. You see, interestingly, there are pulls and pressures on both sides within Ukraine. While the Russian-speaking population naturally tilts more to Russia, and the pro-Europe in the west part of Ukraine or the central part of Ukraine would
so it's move west toward, towards EU, east and south towards Russia. But will Crimea become a part of Russia?
Is Crimea is very likely to become part of Russia.
How so?
I think this referendum most likely will go in favor of almost, because the earlier decision to hold referendum was 68-1. So I think there will be some opposition from Tatars, but I think the vote will be overwhelmingly.
The Tatar leaders have said they will not vote.
They will not vote. So exactly. And then it could be a matter of few weeks, I think, a few months latest. Yeah.
Ambassador Soni, what could be the immediate consequences for the local population of Crimea if Crimea becomes a part of Russia? Because the province to the north of Crimea, Kherson, I don't know whether I'm pronouncing it correctly, has already passed, their legislature passed a resolution in favor of the territorial integrity of Ukraine and said if Crimea goes to Russia, we're going to stop their fresh water, we're going to stop the hydroelectricity, and we're going to stop gas supplies. So what could, how messy is going to be this process?
First of all, let's talk about the Ukrainian debt, which is of the order of $83 billion. Now, $15 billion was what promised by Russia.
Yeah.
The Europeans came back with a counter offer of $13 billion on one side by the Europeans and $1 billion by the US. But the requirement is a lot more. And whether the, you see, when you talk about east and west, which is sustainable? In terms of economic potential,
east is sustainable.
East can be sustained, but west will need a lot of aid flows, and more importantly, what about the energy? Energy, who's going to give them? Europe needs energy, and that's why the lines from Russia are crossing through Ukraine, and which of course is continuing going to be in the future too. The Europeans are also equally keen that there should be no split, because if there was a split, then what will happen to the supplies?
See, and if they don't want the split, why don't they just lay off and let Ukrainians decide what they want?
No, but as it has been mentioned already, it's the question of strategy. They want to weaken Russia through the soft underbelly, which to my mind is
Ukraine. Will be a cost to play?
It is going to be. So to what extent are they going to be ready to underwrite? That's a big question, because even in Europe, except for Germany, who have the capacity to do that?
The EU itself is in a mess, but you wanted to say something
about it. Because that's why on 21st of February, when European Union ministers brokered an agreement with Yanukovych, under which there would have been a kind of continuation of the present setup and a promise of an early election in May. I think that could have been a good compromise. I think it is the United States which moved in.
Yeah.
It is the hawks, you know, in the US administration, the rightist elements, they pushed it to such an extent. And you have, of course, so many reports of Pravi sector, the right-wing thugs, which marched into Kiev, which led to the fleeing of Yanukovych, and the situation aggravated.
Yeah.
The Europeans wanted a settlement, because they are so dependent on the energy supplies, that is the key to the whole Ukrainian issue.
Ambassador Sikri, the Western powers have eagerly embraced the new government of President Alexander Turchynov and Prime Minister Sergei Arseniy Yatsenyuk.
Yeah.
Now, if their appointment is legitimate, if that government in Ukraine is legitimate, why is the Crimean Parliament's resolution for accession to Russia not legitimate?
You are asking a logical question, to which the answer is that the West has double standards. That if you can depose Yanukovych by a street coup, and here a Crimean Parliament and the referendum, if they say that, you know, we want to secede from Ukraine and join Russia, it's equally valid.
So what is the guarantee, Ambassador Devare, that if Crimea becomes part of Russia, the remaining Ukraine will become a democratic state like the countries of EU? Is there any guarantee? Because you're talking about the right-wing threat.
Well, I'm not sure, because, you know, even the eastern parts of Ukraine feel agitated. And if the new government in powers in Kiev do not repeal such laws, draconian laws, regarding restriction of the language. I mean, they have now banned use of Russian and other languages in Ukraine. This will not be acceptable. If this continues, there will be greater unrest in eastern Ukraine, and the situation will not settle.
If I may go back to what was being mentioned, you talk about legitimacy and illegitimacy. When the election to the Verkhovna Rada, which is the parliament, happened, the Europeans were not happy about that they were independently conducted or that the people were allowed to vote.
But they had
so
to
today they are now swearing and standing by them and citing as an example, but whatever happens, and of course they occupied the government buildings.
But they agreed that that election was fair.
No, but by and large, yes, but they were, at that time they were finding only faults. Today they have forgotten all that, now they are standing by that. Okay. So their double standard is what the issue we are talking about.
All right. We need to take a break at this point again. We'll be back again with this discussion in a bit. Don't go away. Welcome back. We're discussing the developments in Crimea. Ambassador Sikri, do you think the warnings of the West, whether it is the EU or the G7, or U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry meeting Sergei Lavrov, the foreign minister of Russia, would they have any impact on Russia? Would it prevent Russia from desisting, the assimilation of Crimea?
I don't think so, because I think that the stakes for Russia are exceedingly high. And if they were to back off, if Putin were to back off, he would suffer domestically, politically, hugely. Apart from the fact that there are real Russian interests at stake. This is not just a question of Crimea and the Ukraine. It is potentially the survival of the Russian state itself. Now, it is like saying, you know, that if one of India's neighbors, which is friendly to us, were to suddenly become hostile to us with the presence of NATO or something or some other forces, would we just sit back? No. Because if it is touching a vital interest, as we did in 1971, we acted.
Okay. All right.
And Russia is doing the same.
Yeah. If I may just add, this is the game of brinkmanship, actually, in my opinion. Because they're trying to see how much they can push the other side and who will blink first. And I agree with Ambassador Sikri that there are two high stakes in Russia for making Ukraine and Crimea independent of outside influence. To a certain extent, yes. But beyond that, they will not accept.
When Russia did not listen to the West in 2008 in the case of Georgia, why would they listen now? So why is the West issuing these empty threats? I mean, they should be following some other strategy.
Quite right, because in South Ossetia and Abkhazia, the Russian, the West did not do anything. They just went on warning. They know that actually President Putin holds high cards, and they don't have any card. This is just, I think, game they are trying to play. Because, you know, he is under no compulsion now. In fact, he is brilliantly using the same weapon or tool of international law in this situation.
Which is?
Because he says that this coup against President Yanukovych was unconstitutional. Whatever happens in Crimea, I mean, the referendum is expected to go in favor of merger, that he will say that it is self-determination, it was a fair election, fair referendum, and therefore that should be acceptable. And if West talks of interference, he cites West has been doing that in Iraq, has done it in Libya, they are doing now Syria. So how can
Afghanistan.
West, Afghanistan, how can West teach interference to President Putin? So all arguments, and in fact, are not in favor of
West. But Sikri, to what extent do you support the Russian notion that the Russian state can go and protect ethnic Russians anywhere? Is President Putin the protector of the Russian world, as it were? And to what extent and how far will he go protecting Russian ethnicities in the states of the former Soviet Union?
Oh, he will go to a large extent. There's no question about it.
But this notion of, you know, being protector of
there are two concepts. One is humanitarian intervention. The second is that if what is happening in a neighboring state is destabilizing your own country. What was our excuse for 1971? That what was happening in East Pakistan was destabilizing India. and the people were coming in. Now, if refugees start coming from eastern Ukraine to Russia, or you say that we are being discriminated against, he will not sit back idly. This is real politics. I think we should get out of this constitutionality and so forth, because there are arguments on both sides. But the real politics is that Russia has vital interests at stake, and it has the means and now the political will to act.
Okay, Ambassador Soni, do you think, therefore, that this real politics was actually strategically planned in 2008 itself, when Russia de facto took over Abkhazia and South Ossetia, that he would have thought at that time that, you know, a few years later a few months later, I might have to do the same thing in Crimea?
It is a long-term policy to try to destabilize at every moment of time, history. That time they couldn't do it for various reasons. This time also they will not go the whole hog.
My question was this a Russian long-term plan that we are seeing in operation?
Russians' long-term plan will be to safeguard their interests. Wherever it happens, they are ready, because after all, they are not
going... Would they have thought of Crimea in 2008?
So far as Crimea is concerned, please remember it has been their base for hundreds of years. Secondly, they did not break any treaty obligation. People are talking a lot more, troops were brought in, but as per the agreement they have, 15,000 is what they were promised. So 25,000 is what they were promised. They have only 15,000 in place. So this is a provocation. They are trying to suggest that they're massing troops on the border.
Okay. I doubt if the Russians had such a long-term planning about Crimea. The European Union, in a way, gave them the opportunity. But the people at large within Ukraine, a substantial portion of the people, do want an association with the European Union, all said and done, with all the closeness to Russia, because they see European Union as a dynamic, more progressive entity. So that, I think, we can't discount. But whether the Russians had already planned this kind of operation, I am not so sanguine about
that. Is there a halfway house still possible, where Crimea gets greater autonomy, short of independence or short of accession to Russia, remains part of a broad Ukrainian framework, and continues?
No, it is possible, but then the West will have to step back a little, and I think President Obama's meeting the Ukrainian Prime Minister in the White House is not a helpful step, because he's gone, taken a very public step. For him to step back would be very difficult. I think Putin would probably have preferred not to have this crisis. All he wants is that Ukraine should be friendly and economically integrated with Russia. And that is why he was very keen that Ukraine should be part of his plan of the Eurasian Union, which has already got Kazakhstan, Belarus, Armenia, and Russia already, Kyrgyzstan also maybe. So without, if Ukraine comes, then it becomes a solid thing. It becomes a counter to the EU. And so he will not want that decisions on Ukraine are taken without Russian interest being taken into account. He has effectively put a spoke in the wheel. He has signaled to the West, there is nothing you can decide on Ukraine without Russian agreement.
So Ambassador Devare, do you think that the crisis in Ukraine and Crimea will extend eventually to other regions, other countries in that region, and prompt them to act in particular ways? For example, Georgia and Moldova may become closer to EU. Belarus and Armenia would foster closer trade, economic and security links with Russia. So are we seeing the pieces moving in this region already in anticipation of what happens in Crimea?
I believe European Union will have to now take again some initiative. In fact, the outline of a kind of a compromise will have to come with certain steps which the European Union, particularly a country like Germany, can propose. Suggesting a rewriting of the Ukrainian constitution, perhaps, under which they could be, instead of the presidential system, can be prime ministerial, with more rights to the provinces within Ukraine, which will also give them the rights to their own language, opportunities to do their business in their language and promotion of their culture and so on. I think the kind of confrontational attitude which the West has adopted will have to be, and the repercussions will be not only on the former Soviet republics, but could be also on other Eastern European countries like Poland or Romania or Bulgaria, where again you know, things are not fully settled.
Okay. We're running out of time, but last word to you. So, in what way do you see this crisis spreading to other peripheral states or the west of Russia?
It has potential to grow much more. Yeah. The issue is to what extent the Europeans will be able to pay a price, because it is to pay a price. I don't think at the present moment they are ready for that. Mm. For the time being, therefore, some kind of a wire media will be found that the crisis is de-escalated and perhaps go in for further discussion as to what will be the shape of things to come in the future.
All right. Thank you very much. And let's hope the crisis gets de-escalated and doesn't become another major war and beginning of a Cold War.
Cold War, yes.
Definitely.
So thank you very much for analyzing the situation. That's all we have for you today. We'll be back again next week with another interesting issue. Till then, goodbye.